turn in your Bibles to, or do we want to turn first? We'll turn to Philippians chapter 3, verse 10, and we'll look there in just a moment. We started this message last week. We just got into it about changing the trend as we're walking into this new year. Want to challenge each one of us, along with myself, in our walk with the Lord, and our commitment to the Lord and the work of His kingdom, and in our love for and submission to the Word of God, and our commitment to our local church. And I'm thankful for the commitment that many of you sitting here have to this church. You know, we're talking about Penny decorating. You find out that she was here all week, taking things down, putting things up. It takes a lot of time, a lot of commitment to do that, to make things nice. And, you know, that's the commitment we're talking about. It takes a lot of commitment to make sure the monies are counted right and they're put in the bank, they're used right, sent out to the right places, all those things. It takes a lot of commitment from folks. The fellows get together. We have meetings to deal with things in the church, and it takes time and it takes effort. So it's something we do each month. And it takes commitment. It takes time to prepare the Sunday school lessons, to read that lesson, take a little time to do that. It takes commitment, and it does take obedience to what the Lord would have us to do. And we want to have that kind of commitment, even in the giving, as we give in the offering. You know, it's a blessing to see the financial giving of this little church. It's pretty amazing. And so, you know, but it still takes what? Commitment to your church, and we're thankful for that. And as we go into a new year, we looked last week or just mentioned about it's a new opportunity. It's every day is a new day with the Lord. And you may have failed the day before, but that's all right. The Lord will pick you back up, and we'll move on into the next day and ask God to give us strength to do what He'd have us to do. And we have a new year, a new start, new opportunities. And I shared a little quote by Benjamin Franklin: be at war with your vices, at peace with your neighbors, and let every new year find you a better person. And that's my goal is, right? Every year, actually every day, every year, to be farther along in my relationship with the Lord, be more committed to Him, more committed to His Word, to know Him better, to know His Word better. And I'm talking about knowing Him. And that's where our verse is here in Philippians chapter 3, verse 10, that I may know Him. And that's not talking about knowing about Him. That's talking about knowing Him personally and intimately, that I might know what He thinks, what He says, what He wants. It's not about me. It's about Him. And that's what Paul said. Paul said, I know all the other stuff. I've been there. I learned that. He said, but it's nothing like knowing Christ and knowing Him intimately and personally. And that's what we want to be challenged with. And the first thing that I had on the list last week was, as on your outline, is having a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Amen. That's what this church is about. It's not about going to church. It's not about religion. It's about having a relationship with Jesus Christ. Do you know Him as your Savior? Do you know Him as your Lord? And when you do, these other things will be blessings that come. You'll have a desire to have some time alone with Him. You'll have desire to pray. You'll have desire to be in His Word. You'll have desires to tell other people about Christ. You'll have desires to give. You know, like I shared, when I used to think that churches, all they wanted was your money. I'd heard that. I didn't know it. I'd never been inside of one. And then the pastor that led us to the Lord, first thing he said, you know, if you don't want to give with a willing heart, God doesn't need your money. Wow, he's kind of different. And the scriptures tell us that, right, to give with a cheerful heart, willingly. You know, I don't mind. I love giving to the Lord. You can't outgive the Lord, right? That's a blessing. And so that's those things. And I gave you a little outline there, man's problem. If we're sharing the gospel, that we're all sinners. God's solution, Calvary. And man's responsibility is by faith to receive that promise. And it sounds easy, and it is easy enough that a child can do it. But it's so difficult for the mind to comprehend that the gift of salvation cost me nothing. It cost him everything. And we're so geared to thinking, I have to do something to get something. But the Bible says it doesn't. And of course, we also know as believers that it is God that opens the mind and the heart to receive that blessed gift. Again, we want to pray that you all have a relationship with the Lord so that we can enjoy this fellowship for how long? All the way through eternity. And we're going to have some talented musicians up there. We're going to have some great singers, and God's got an angel choir. And it's going to be quite a time. And we're going to hear him teaching the word. We're going to walk streets of gold, no sin, all those wonderful things. And we want to have everybody there, right? All of our family members, so we got a big job to do. Number two that I have on your list there, living our lives based upon biblical principles. And where do you find that? You find that in God's word. Psalm 119 says, your word is a lamp to my feet and a what? A light to my path. Boy, I tell you what, we're living in a dark, dark world. And the only way to find your way through is through the light of God's word. Biblical principles. I have a definition for you, I believe, on your outline. God's absolute truth, which is right for all people, for all times, and for all places. Isn't that great? God's absolute truth, which is right for all people, for all times, and for all places. Isaiah says it this way in Isaiah 28:10, for precept must be upon precept, precept upon precept, line upon line, line upon line, here a little, there a little. And you know what? That's what I find as I'm growing with the Lord. I'm putting another piece together here, another piece together here, all the way on my walk, my relationship with people, my responsibility as a pastor, my responsibility as a husband, as a father, my responsibility in knowing what God's plan is for the future. A little piece gets put together here. I see things happening, and I see pieces getting put together. And I'm learning all the time, a little here, a little there. You know, and that's the way it was when I got the privilege of going to Bible college, and they started teaching me this and teaching me this, but the little pieces started clicking together. And you know what? I wish I could remember everything they taught me, but I don't. But you know what? I'm confident that God is still in the business of teaching me. And that's what Paul went on to say in that Philippians passage. He says, brethren, not that I have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead, I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. He said, I keep on moving forward, and God keeps on putting the puzzles together for me. And you know, one day I'll wake up in his presence, and it all makes sense. Until then, I'm just going to, as Bud brings up the song, I'm just going to trust and what? Obey. It's pretty simple. Isn't the walk of faith is real simple in principle, but real hard in practice? Because we have lots of things that get in the way. We have an enemy. We have the flesh. We have the world. And it just wants to get in the way and living our lives based upon promises. Remember, when God says it's right, it's always right. It's always right. And it'll never be wrong. And that's where the world is messing things up today. As Isaiah said, when you start saying that things are right when they're wrong and things that are evil are good, you've got it all wrong, and it's happening. Number one, have a relationship with him. Number two, get devoted to the principles in God's word. When we were taught about, I was talking about giving, and we'll talk just a minute more about that. We were taught when we were first saved that God would have us to give a tenth to start out. And so we learned that as a biblical principle. And so we learned to set that aside first off. That was a principle. And as you study that principle out, that you can't outgive God. And God said, if you give what you're able to give, you don't, I don't care what figure you use. I don't think that's important. I think if God's given you something to give, give it. But make sure you give it to him first and not put him at the end of the list. And that's why so many people think they can't give, because they put God at the end of the list. But you need to put God at the first of the list. He said he'll take on the rest of the list. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, then all these things he'll what? Add it unto you. Sorry, Larry, just can't get that one out of me either. Oh, well. We thank God for that old King James Version. It is great. But number three, by having a personal, quiet time, time alone with the Lord, in prayer and in his word. It says in Luke, turn to Luke chapter 10, just for a moment. You know the story well of Mary and Martha. And it says this about Mary. Now, Martha was a worker. She is a busybody. She got things done. She saw something needed to be done in the church. Guess what? First one in the list, Martha was doing it. She wasn't talking about it. She was doing it. And there's nothing wrong with that. But we want to make sure that we don't leave out this part. Luke chapter 10 and verse 39 says, "And she had a sister called Mary, who also sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word." And just the next couple of verses, "But Martha was distracted with much serving." That's what can happen in the Christian life. Even in church, we can get so busy that we forget why we're here. It's about him and our relationship with him. It's not just about service. We want to do service, but make sure you don't leave out the one you're serving. And that's what he said. "And she approached him and said, 'Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to serve alone? Therefore, tell her to help me.' And Jesus answered and said to her, 'Martha, Martha.'" You might need to put your name in there. "And John, John," I'll put my name in there, "you're worried and troubled about many things, but one thing is needed, and Mary has chosen the good part, which will not be taken away from her." And what was that good part? Sitting at his feet and learning from him. You can't beat it. And you do that through the prayer and through the reading of the word. Even in Matthew 14:23, it says Jesus, after a busy day, it says, "After he had dismissed the crowds, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone." Folks, you need to learn to get alone with God and listen to him. Sometimes shut the mouth. Turn off the things that are going on in your head. It's hard. Look into the word and ask God to talk to you and pray about it with him. Prayer can be a two-way conversation. God talking to you through his word. And I'm going to say this now, be careful here, but sometimes it feels like he talks to you in an audible voice. And I'm not saying it's a speakerphone, but sometimes it sounds like it's a speakerphone. Or like sometimes in the Old Testament, it says he came with a still, small voice. And we get so busy that we don't hear that voice. And we were talking about that this morning when Abraham's offering Isaac. And when he got that knife drawn up here and was ready to plunge it down, and the angel of the Lord said, "Abraham, aren't you glad he's listening?" Well, Isaac was glad that he was listening. When Isaac's looking up at that knife saying, "Whew, that was a close one. Dad, I'm glad you was listening." And how many times have we not listened, and then when we've had something happen, look back and said, "Could have had a V8. I didn't listen," and I think, "Oh, well, you told me that. And I knew you said that, and I didn't listen. I didn't respond." Having some time alone and with the Lord. It says in Psalm 5:3, "My voice you shall hear in the morning, O Lord. In the morning I will direct it to you and I will look up." And taking some time, whether it's morning, midday, or throughout the day, whenever you get a chance, spend a little bit of time alone with the Lord and let him talk to you. And we have all kinds of devotional books, all kinds of prayer journals, all kinds of things that are all focused to help you. Bill Hybels, in his book, Too Busy Not to Pray, he's one of these guys that's always thinking a step ahead and always busy with the big church that he had. And so he learned to write his prayers down. And that way it focused his attention upon what he was doing. And it stopped him from being distracted. Dr. Jeremiah types his stuff into his computer now that someone set it up for him, because he's not real computer literate. And he said he types that things in, it helps him focus. And so maybe if you're a computer person, you got an iPad or whatever, you can do that. But you can get your devotional time, you can get it on your phone. It comes every day. If you have a smartphone, I know it's just hard not to be smart enough to operate the phone. But it comes there. And so we have no excuse. What I'm saying is to not get a little time. And maybe you need to just set that stupid phone down. Maybe you need to shut that computer off. Because we know that people are, or that TV, or that radio. And I've even learned that. I do a lot of driving now and without the radio on, because I talk to God while I'm driving. I'm memorizing verses. I should be paying attention to the road. My wife's looking at me with that look, and I'm going to ignore her. I've already learned not to do that. But it's still a challenge to do on a regular basis. And we need, each one of us here need, and I learned when I was in Bible college about having, reading through the scriptures, having a time alone with God. Word of Life was great with their quiet time diaries. I used to do that with all of our teenagers, because I thought if we would require them to do it, well, why shouldn't the pastor do it? And I learned those verses along with them, even though I wasn't in there teaching them, our youth pastor was. But that's all right. But it's a good training tool. It's a good tool to get us every day into the Word, every day, and then writing down your prayer request, and then maybe writing down when God answers them. And then making sure you do what? You thank Him for it. Make sure you thank Him for answered prayers. So number four, or just to wrap that up, prayer and personal scripture application are essential to a growing, obedient Christian. Number four, which we've been working on, is scripture memory. Turn over to Psalm 119. Psalm 119. Of course, you know that's about in the middle of your Bible, and it's about the longest book in your Bible. As far as Psalms go, a whole psalm based upon what? The Word of God. I know a couple people have memorized this psalm. I would have to use the short version of Psalm 19. But anyhow, we memorized last year, verse 18, "Open my eyes that I may see wondrous things from your law." When you get ready to read the scriptures, when you get time to be alone with God in the Word, pray that prayer before you start. Lord, open my eyes to what you would have for me today from your Word. Talk to me. Lord, talk to me. I'm listening. Here I am. And in verse 11, it says, "Your Word I have hidden in my heart, that I might not sin against you." And that word hidden there means to store up. Scripture memory is so important. I am amazed at the verses that I can even remember still when I was first saved in that first class that we were learning a memory verse each week in that course, the Navigator's course, Growing in Christ. And I can still remember many of those verses I learned clear back then. Now, sometimes I thought I forgot them. But the Holy Spirit has promised that when I need those things, if I've hidden them there, guess what? He brings them up. And that can be good, and it can also be convicting. Because I've learned that certain things are sin. And when all of a sudden I do one of those things, the Holy Spirit zaps me with one of those verses. And he says, hey, you know better. You ever tell that to your kids? The Holy Spirit does that. And he'll put his finger right on the problem, and he won't take it off until you deal with it. And that's the way the Lord is hiding that word in my heart, that you might not sin against God. But his delight, it says in Psalm 1:2, is in the law of the Lord, and in his law he meditates day and what? And I told you about the pastor that we had in Pennsylvania. He was an amazing man when it came to brevity of words and knowing the word. He could say a lot in a little bit of time, but he also spent his life, he jogged miles every day, and guess what he had playing in his head? The Word of God. He went to sleep with the Word of God playing on tape. Everything he did focused around hearing and knowing the Word of God. And Pastor Regan, I love him. I wished I'd get a chance to talk to him again tomorrow. He's just a wonderful, godly man that was just a blessing because he had hidden the Word in his heart. Tells us in the New Testament, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. That word dwell there means to take up residence, to be at home. Tells us in 1 John that we know when we're becoming worldly, when God's commandments become a burden. When I start struggling with doing what's right, it tells me that I'm becoming more and more like the world. Because I have been born again. I am now a son of God. I'm a child of God. And I should have in my heart and in my minds the things of God. And you know what? There's a joy to being obedient to what I know. And I'm confident that God will bless his word. You'll never be sorry for the things you memorize and put in your heart from the word of God. Internalizing scripture and connecting it and applying it to life's needs and problems is essential to a growing, obedient Christian. And this will come, number five, being in Bible study. It says in the King James, 2 Timothy 2:15, study to show thyself approved unto God, a worker who does not need to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. The New King James says, be diligent to show yourself approved. Study. Taking a little time to maybe looking up the meanings of a couple words, even in their English version. But going beyond that sometimes into what it says in the Greek. And you say, well, I don't know Greek and I don't know Hebrew. You don't have to know any of those things. They got dictionaries that just share those things with you. Very easy. You look up the English word and it tells you what it means in the Greek, in the Hebrew. It's just, it's a blessing to have. You know, the word tells us in 2 Timothy 3:16, all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable. It's profitable for doctrine. That's teaching. That tells us what's right. For reproof. That tells us what's wrong. For correction. That tells us that we are wrong. And for instruction in righteousness, how to stay right. That the man of God or the woman of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. The word of God will change your life. It'll change your thinking. Remember, it tells us in Romans 12:2 that be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God. You can't know what the will of God is if you don't know the Word of God. It's that simple. Greg is sharing with us this morning again his desire to see people back into the Word. And I see this a couple times, and I've been looking through things. A five-minute Bible. I'm saying it's time, folks, we get past 5 minutes. Amen. See, we have a Christian world in the United States that's very shallow because they don't know the Word of God. And it's a shame because we have it in more translations than you all can handle. We can get it read to us. Everything. And it's there, but it seems like folks don't have that hunger, that thirst. We need to pray for one another that God will give us a thirst and a hunger to know the Word. Be in Bible study. That's why we come to Sunday school. That's why we have it on Wednesday nights. That's why we have preaching on Sundays. So get us into where? The Word. But I'm going to tell you what, Sunday and Wednesday and Sunday school is not enough. Especially if you're not doing the teaching. You know, the teacher always learns more than the rest of the people. Because when you're learning to teach somebody, there's all kinds of stuff. When I'm preparing a message, I get so much stuff, and I'm trying to sort out how can I narrow this down. But I'm always blessed more than you'll ever be blessed, unless you're doing it for yourself. I'm just telling you that. It's just the way it works. It's the way the Lord made it. Study the Word with it in its context and truth, properly applying it to your life. And that's what it tells us also there in Timothy, to rightly divide the Word of truth. Check it out in context. Make sure you're not pulling something out that's not what God's saying. Make sure you're careful there. Number, our next one on our list here so we can finish these next couple, by doing Christian service. Acts 1:8. Turn there with me if you would. Acts 1:8. You know the verse well. I was seeing a book the other day. A guy wrote the problem with well-known verses. And a lot of people can quote them, but are you doing them? Acts 1:8. Here Jesus speaking to the apostles. But you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and in Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. That word witnesses there could be representative. It also is where we get the word martyr. God says that you are his witnesses. When you get saved, he doesn't say you might be. He says you shall be my witnesses. God would have you to do service. He says in Matthew 28, go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Son, Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always. That's one guy said, that's why he said, don't fly. He says, lo, I'm with you always. Even to the end of the age, he's given us a commission to go out, see folks saved, and teach them the things of the Word of God. To be involved in Christian service, to be involved. God gave every one of us a gift. 1 Peter 4:10 says, as each one has received a gift, minister it to one another. God has given different one of us. Like Penny said, she just needs to fix the church up. That's her gift. Playing the piano, playing the organ, playing the trombone, leading music, being a pastor, cleaning the church. All those things that God's given us abilities to do, we need to all be doing it. Aren't you glad that Bob takes care of running the sound and puts that puts the video on there? It does all the work for the drive-in church, all that behind that. Julie's making sure that you have food to eat when you get done. Thank God for gifts. Just think if they didn't do it. What do we do then? That's what happens with the church. Folks give. Some folks are great givers. Thank God for those folks. We all ought to be giving, but some just seem to be able to excel in that. Some folks seem to be able to excel in witnessing. Whatever your gift is, use it to its fullest extent here in the church. And that's what I have in number 7, being faithful to the local church. It says in Hebrews 10:25, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, but exhorting one another. That word could be encouraging. In the NIV, I think it changes it to that. encouraging one another, and so much more as you see the day approaching. And if you don't think we're getting close, just talk to Brother Ron. We don't call him Rapture Ron for nothing. He's got his eyes on him. He's got his eyes on that future coming, which motivates us, right? We have work to finish. We're getting excited because I can't wait. I'm like the Apostle John said, come soon, Lord Jesus. But then when I think that, I also love the Lord's promise that he's waiting because he's not willing that what? Any should perish. Oh, I got so many family members and people I know that need to get saved. I hate to think of them going to a Christless eternity or living through that 7 years of hell upon this earth. Not only will they feel the wrath of the devil and Satan, they'll see the wrath of God upon this word and world, and it's going to be torn apart like no one's ever seen before. That's what Jesus said. No one has ever seen the things that have happened before that's going to happen during that 7 years. And many of those people will still refuse to repent and get saved and spend eternity in hell separated from God. Wow. You know, it's amazing how much of an encouragement you can be just by coming on Sunday morning. It says not forsaking there. It could be say, don't make it a habit. I challenge some folks sometimes. They say, yeah, I go to church on a regular basis. And I say, put a red X on your calendar and see how many X's you have on there at the end of the year. You'd be surprised sometimes how many X's are missing. Because it seems like it can become, you miss one Sunday. And there's not, I understand we miss church. Well, they don't like it when I miss. But I've had to call in sick before. I've had to do that sometimes. And sometimes things happen. And that's all right. But don't make it a what? A habit. Don't make it a habit. Being faithful to the local church. And it's a necessity to have the blessings, and we've talked about it here, the blessings of being part of this church family. When I have a need, I can't wait to share it with my church family, to be prayed about and see what God does. We have some family that doesn't do that. They'll go through all kinds of problems, and they don't share it with their church. I said, what's wrong with you? Are you afraid that they'll know that you're wanting? Well, I tell you what, I'm wanting. And I'm wanting all the prayers you'll give me. And when I need help and I need encouragement, I'm coming right to my church family. Because I feel that we should be able to share those things with one another. And we ought to be encouraged when folks give and help and all those things. And I've been part of those. I'll tell you what, I ate a bunch of meals from people in this church. Shirley and I both did. Because I am not a cook. That's not my calling. I can make oatmeal instant. I can. When you're starving, it tastes good. Thank God for those folks that are there. And the last one there, number 8. Being accountable to one another. Are you willing? It says this in Galatians 6. Brethren, if a man is overtaken or caught in any trespass, you who are spiritual, restore such a one in the spirit of gentleness. Consider yourself, lest you be tempted. Bear one another's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ. Allowing yourself to be held accountable by the local church, to the leadership, and the people sitting beside you in the pew, even if that's your wife or your husband. Being held accountable to one another. We need accountability. It says in James, it says, confess your trespasses to one another and pray for one another. When I have a shortcoming in my life, I can share it with you and you can pray that God will give me victory in that area, right? We all stumble. I'm going to tell you what. I can tell you sometimes I think things and say things I shouldn't. My wife reminds me, and I'm glad of that. I'm glad that she loves me enough that she's not afraid to tell me that I called that guy that drove by us and cut me off or whatever it was, that he's an idiot, a jerk, or whatever else I can think of real quick. You know, Christian stuff. No swear words. But you know what? The Lord taught us a long time ago, it really is the intent and the attitude behind the thoughts that's the problem. He said, even to think about killing somebody and it's in your heart is bad news. And sometimes I get aggravated at these people that should never be in a vehicle. And I say things and think things that I shouldn't. Sometimes I hit my thumb with a... And I may not say it, but I was thinking it. Woo, it hurts. yeah. But anyhow, personal accountability. It says in Proverbs 27:17, as iron sharpens iron, so a man sharpens the countenance of his friend. You know what? Have good friends that hold you accountable. You know what? I don't know a good man of God at any time in any place that wouldn't tell you they didn't have good Christian friends that wasn't afraid to point their finger in his chest and say, you know what? You're messing up. And I can think of a dear brother that probably not too long ago wished he'd had someone there talking with him. And somewhere along the line, his personal accountability got messed up. Now, we're ultimately accountable to God, but we need to have someone with skin on sometimes to help us and to guide us and to direct us. That's what we're supposed to do as a church family. Be called into account of our life and whatever it is. So I want to challenge you as we finish up, along with myself, to step up to the challenge of Scripture and do God's work in God's way that will get God's results and that will reach this community with the gospel of Jesus Christ, that we'll see folks saved, brought into the church, taught, discipled, that they're able to go out and lead other folks to Christ, and that multiplying effect could fill this church building up real quick. Because remember how many people the Lord had? 12. And one of them turned out to be the devil's advocate. So with 11, he turned the world upside down. I think there's more than 11 here today. Last week, not many. But this week, more than 11. And we can do that. I'll leave you with this challenge from Joshua 24:15. Joshua says, but as for me and my house, we will what?
Serve the Lord.
Father, help us to be on fire for you, to be excited to have the opportunity to serve you, to have your word in our language, there for us to be able to read, to hear, to study, to pray, to be obedient to. Thank you for this church that exhibits your love to one another and to you. And I pray you'll challenge each one of us to step up each year to be more like our Savior. We thank you for your patience, your grace. We thank you for the power of your Spirit that takes the Word of God and uses it as a knife to do surgery on our hearts and our minds. And Father, it's a living Word. It's an active Word, and it's working. And we pray that we would share it with one another, that we would live it in our lives, that we would share it with the world. We just commit this new year to you, Father. Use it for your honor and your glory. And I ask that in Jesus' name. Amen.